Yesterday I forgot to introduce myself. So my name is Andy Adivijaya, and despite my name, I'm born in Hamburg, Germany. Actually, yesterday I was told I'm too much of a German because I insisted that Herbert should turn his flag around. So I'm talking about the other thing that Anke Cheese already mentioned. It's Next.js. So I'm also talking about using Silverstripe as a headless CMS, but working with Next.js. So my basic assumption is headless is here to stay, and Silverstripe CMS is the best open source solution. It's not that everything has to be headless, but I think that headless is a very good idea, and there are new players on the board, and Silverstripe is for me the best solution for my projects. An overview. So I'm starting with a overview of server-side rendering and why you should do it. Then I will continue with headless Silverstripe CMS and why you should do it. And then I will present a small package which I put together, which is a Next.js and Silverstripe starter. I think it's very easy for you to try it out this way. So why SSR? Should I care? Is it worth it? Oh, I'm very sorry. That's my fault. One moment. Thanks, Werner. Yeah. So I'm going one slide back. Overview. Why SSR? Why headless Silverstripe CMS, and how can I start? So first section, why SSR, should I care, is it worth it? I'm coming from a different perspective than most developers, I think. I am working as a Silverstripe developer, but I'm also working as a Next.js developer in some projects, and I was forced to work with Java backends and JavaScript CMSs. And I would like to use Silverstripe CMS because I think it's the best. And I launched own projects with Next.js in Silverstripe CMS. So I'm not coming from content first, but from front-end developing. The trend towards single-page apps is because of interaction possibilities, and but there are certain disadvantages of single page apps. It's SEO, browser history, and time to first render. And there are two major solutions for that: server-side rendering via Gatsby, or static generators like Gatsby or Jekyll or others. And the other side is server-side rendering. That's the major player is Next.js. Yeah, I'm sorry, Stacy. I have to mention this great slide of you from last year. Yeah, that's right. You there's kind of bloat running around, and it's very much JavaScript that you have to get things started. But I think it's also some kind of evolution. Aaron had a similar slide on his deck. We all started with plain HTML and Dreamweaver and frameworks. The older ones of us. And then continued with plain PHP and Smarty. Smarty was very good. And then it went to jQuery. No one wants to use jQuery now. And then React. And I think server-side rendering is just a logical evolution for front-end development. Just a quick demo of Next.js side. So this is a page. Actually, it's not really finished. I forced the client to launch it because I wanted to show it today. And it's just a normal site, but it's maybe you can see that it's certainly fast. If I turn on the... can you see that? So if you look at the network tab, then you see that on each page load, not a page is loaded, but a JSON file. This is very small, and the whole rendering, the whole application is in the front end. So that's not server-side rendering, that's the opposite of it. But if I turn off JavaScript, I just learned how to do that. So now you can see that there is no AJAX request, but there are plain HTML files served from the server. The red ones are the JavaScript files, which are ignored, but it does work plain server-side. I have to say that not everything works. The filters are not really working. But this is also not my main goal. I have to turn on JavaScript again. Oh, it's on. Okay. So, so any hard reload will load an HTML, but all clicks by the users load pages as XML HTTP request. And this is really nice. So Next.js has evolved this year, and it's really good. And there are two ways to use Next.js. The first one is to get static content. They also included some static rendering, and they also have a really cool new feature: static can be dynamic, so that you have a static rendering at build time, but as you are running it on a Next.js server, you can revalidate it. So you can add content, and the content that was there at build time will be static, and others will be dynamic. I didn't try that, but it's really interesting. I'm still feel strange about, I don't feel good to deliver static websites. I really like to have dynamic websites, and I also don't have the requirement for large scale websites in most projects. So this is how Next.js works. The client, very simple graphic. The client talks to the Next.js server, and the Next.js server loads data from a backend server. It's also possible to integrate multiple backend servers, but in my experience, the integration point was always the backend server, so that other things would be integrated in the backend. What we need is our dynamic pages. The default Next.js logic is to use page JavaScript documents in a pages folder, and a former solution was to have a custom server JS that rewrites to one page in the pages folder, but now they have a new logic to have dynamic names. That's on the bottom. It's a very strange naming. I think it's double bracket with three dots. That means that everything in this folder and below that folder will be served from this file. So the mechanism to fetch data from the backend server is also very simple. It's just a function get server side props, and actually the line which can you see my cursor? I'm not sure. The it's just because of TypeScript that TypeScript wants me to be sure that this is a string, and we are fetching get page data. Thanks. Get page data is an API function which delivers the data from the backend. I will show that later. And then we deliver this props file, and this is the JSON which is served by the Next.js server. So why Silverstripe CMS as a headless CMS? Now, what's used on the market? The criteria is we have a simple setup, mostly config and low maintenance. Yeah, the headless CMS systems try to be front-end independent, but in my projects, you always needed to have pages, you had to have something like page elements, you had to have something like navigation, and the end custom data, and most of the hosted CMS systems, it's logical to use a hosted CMS because of the low maintenance. It was very difficult to get some kind of structured menu out of the CMS. And also, these hosted CMS are expensive and have strange limitations. You pay per page. What the hell? So I don't want to use a hosted CMS. I want to use a self-hosted CMS. There are strange new players which have some backend but no front end, okay, and all old players with APIs. So maybe you could use WordPress as a headless CMS, but we don't want to. So I don't want to go into depth why Silverstripe CMS is the right thing, because you all know why you like Silverstripe. But like Sam, I would like to advertise to use Silverstripe as a development framework. Basic admin interfaces are a matter of configuration, but configuration in code, you can, this is, as you know, this is a complete example how to have a basic admin interface in Silverstripe. So the strength of Silverstripe is not templates and modules and such things, but to create solutions that fit to the customer project. Just one example. This is a customer that has a course booking system, and it's integrated in a website. So the website is not by me. That's I think it's Joomla. And in this iframe, it's not an iframe. It's a widget, JavaScript widget. I have a React front end where I can have these bookings. And this React front end talks to a headless Silverstripe. I cannot show that, but you can imagine it's a simple model admin. And the thing is, the Silverstripe syncs with Microsoft Dynamics CRM via SOAP, And it was really, it was not easy, but it was a really nice experience as you can match the Dynamics models with your Silverstripe models. And it was really to get models in and out for Sync. So how do we do with it? I have a starter. Can I? Oh, no. I will put this in the chat. I'm sorry, I did not have time to do the README at the moment, but you can browse the folders. And I will have a short demo. So this is the front end of the demo side. This is the Silverstripe backend. So if I go in there, and publish it, then you see the update in the preview. The draft mode is not working at the moment. That's a kind of, matter of the resolver. So we're using simple elements. Preview is working. And yeah, there was some issues with the redirector page. So I have a redirect test and it's working now. That was not that easy. And if you look into the structure, I've put together this starter with Next.js and Silverstripe in one repository. In other projects, we have separated repositories, but most of the time you need both repositories, so you can also do it in one repository. We have the Silverstripe installation in a backend folder. In the main folder, there are also storybook pages, is for Next.js pages, public, that's for Next.js static files, in this time only fonts. And we have this JavaScript code. We have no templates. And we have no front-end code in the back-end. I see here's in my screenshot, there's still the themes folder that shouldn't be there. So there's no need for a theme folder in this case. To set up it, you just clone the repository and you edit the env. I will show it on the next slide. Then you go to backend and install your PHP dependencies, and then you go one up and install your JS dependencies and start your dev server. If you don't know this, maybe it's nice to know. One moment. I just want to show the one moment. Yeah. I just wanted to show what dev server means on the if you're client side developing. You can just change things here. And it will instantly reload on the website. So this is a very nice experience for front-end development. You also have a storybook where you can view the elements alone, the components. So back to my slides. The JavaScript stack I'm using is Next.js. Next.js is a framework for React. And I'm using TypeScript, styled components, and Storybook. Styled components, I was very suspicious when it came out and when I first created styles in JavaScript. But it's really nice to have everything in one page. This is a simplified example of one functional component. You have a FAQ element. It has a state. It's open or it's not open. And you have this code where you have a headline and a text content. And you have the styles up here. And depending on the visibility of the state, it displays the content or not. It's a very good method to have really components you can really reuse and which work alone. So the config is one config for both, for the front end and the back end. This is a standard Silverstripe configuration, and we have two configuration parameters for the front end. It's a front end URL that is needed for the preview URL, and we have in the API path that's needed for fetching the data from the back end. As you see, I'm using a standard Apache on my computer. So in the backend, we have a page and we have two elements, text element and FAQ element. I won't explain that further. So we are using GraphQL for the fetch of the data. We are not always using GraphQL, and the kulturelle Bildung example, which I showed first, is not with GraphQL, but it uses REST. That has some pros and cons. But I think GraphQL is the future. I'm using scaffolding in YAML with a custom page resolver for fetching pages. Here you can see I'm defining the page with fields. And then I have two operations. Actually, only this is used. This is a read one operation. And from the page, we can also query elements. A menu is a function of the page, and children. And we have the elements, which use a trick to get all content fields. Most important is the resolver, and the resolver just gets an URL segment. It's the wrong name. It's the whole path with slashes in it, and then looks up the page, which we want to have. The single most important tool you need if you work with GraphQL is GraphQL. I will show it. That's evil. So this is GraphQL. So you can put up, you can test your queries, and you get the result on the right. So if you do something, then you can see what the backend is delivering. This is very important to test it out before you put it into the JavaScript. So in JavaScript, I use a simple fetch API function, which is just only a fetch and returns the result as a JSON. And here you we have to, the query which I which I showed in the GraphQL, but I also but I translate the backend fields to lowercase because it's really strange to work with uppercase variables in JavaScript. So that's the thing I'm working with. This is the function which gets called by get server side props, which I showed earlier. So this thing needs some tricks to work. The first is get content fields. I'm waiting for GraphQL 4 so that I can query subtypes. You can, at the moment, it's very difficult to get different fields from, say, different element types. The page has also some tricks. The one is a front-end link. You only need this because of the redirector page. Then the menu, that this calls the function from the page controller. Remember, when calling things by GraphQL, you don't have a controller. And then you have the preview link that's used by the admin CMS to generate the preview, and this just gets the environment from the parameter from the environment and adds the link. We can also not use link or section at the moment because it uses director get char page, and this uses also controller char and throws a very bad error. We would have to re-implement this. So one thing is it's more difficult to host. You will have to run a Node.js server, and this is somewhat strange for a PHP developer, but it's the normal case in all other languages, say in Java or in Python. You always have to start a server and have it running. And it's not that difficult. You just build your package, and then you start it with PM2, that's a process runner. And later on, you just can restart it. In Nginx, I'm using Nginx for this hosting. I'm always using two routes. The first is a rewrite to the Silverstripe public folder, as usual. And the second is a proxy to the JavaScript server, which runs on a port. I will not get into this. I'm also not a server guy, so I appreciate every improvements. But I'm putting this here in here for to have the slides complete. So my conclusion, as Colin said in the chat, yes, it's a really important thing that's not always the right tool. But I think what's important is that headless is here to stay, and that Next.js and headless Silverstripe CMS is really easy to set up. And I would like to see positioning for Silverstripe CMS as a headless CMS. I think I'm really good in solving problems, but I'm really bad in creating products to reuse. So I would appreciate if someone is interested to work on this. So I fetched up the time, yeah. thank you. I'm happy to speak with you about headless and SSR or anything else. Thank you. Julian?
Andy, actually, I just didn't expect you to finish on time. That's why I wasn't pushing it so far. Any questions for Andy? Don't be shy, folks. Do I really have to ask Johannes if he has a question?
Oh, he's
Very
sparing them
much.
up for afternoon.
I think so. Nobody? Okay, well then, Andy, thank you a lot. I think we will have you for the GraphQL and headless panel discussion at 2 p.m., right?
Yes, I'm there. I will be there.
Cool. So, see you
Thank you.
again in 3 hours. Bye.
Yeah. Goodbye.